So hello friends and welcome to Cafe Mutual YouTube channel. Friends, we all know that money is the most dearest thing to people in life. Despite this, the behavioral aspect of money has been researched recently. In fact, still in most personal finance decisions, number crunching and mathematical calculations override logic. In this episode, we will learn about money and human behavior. To give justice to this topic, we have with us the author of most popular newsletter series, A Stoic Investor. Yes, you guessed it right. We have with us Nimesh Chandan, Head of Investment Equities at Canara Robeco Mutual Fund. Welcome, Nimesh.
Thank you. Thank you, Nishant. I wish all of you, people who are listening, are happy and healthy and their loved ones are safe. And hope we get through this pandemic very quickly.
Yeah. So Nimesh, my first question to you is that I have been following your newsletter, A Stoic Investor, for quite some time now. So last year during COVID times, you talked about how monetary concerns erode cognitive performance of people. So since we have been going through similar situation due to health crisis and uncertainty in economy, so what would be the impact on various businesses of this monetary concerns?
Let's put it as two aspects. One is individual behavior in, say, spending and consumption that takes place. And the second is the impact we see on certain businesses. So first of all, when people are struggling due to certain pandemic, certain fear, there is a certain preference for liquidity. They want to keep some money with them, spend a little less. They postpone certain purchases. Clearly, when there are lockdowns also, there are restrictions on consuming certain items. And what happens is people try to fit a lot of it into a small bag. So they try to omit certain items from their budget and try to restrict themselves to what they need as far as their basic needs are concerned. And historically, there have been experiments. And when people are worried about money, it affects their decision making in other aspects of life also. So I think to some extent, consumption takes a little breather or slowdown. And we saw last year and probably what we are seeing now that there is a certain slowdown in terms of certain consumer items. On the other side, the businesses have a different impact. Now, because people are looking at only basic necessities and trying to look at buying certain things that they really need and the brands that they trust, when they are going to the shop, they are not spending too much time there. They're picking up whatever they need quickly and the brand they trust because they want to get out of the shop very quickly. Or when they're ordering something, they just want to quickly click on whatever brands they trust and they like. So within businesses, what has happened is a lot of market share has moved from unorganized to organized. Companies that have strong brand performances, companies that offer their clients a range of products within various price levels. So like, you know, they can move up and down the value in their product line. So those companies have been more successful. Companies that are able to get their distribution right, they leverage technology and get their products and services to their distributors better, they are doing very well. So there has been a shift of market share, if you see, since this beginning of this pandemic and especially in the last year, where unorganized to organized and companies that are having a good brand, good distribution, have done better by getting more market share.
So Nimesh, how is equity market placed to tackle this situation? And what are the key triggers and risks for the markets currently?
So I would say compared to last year, in the second wave, we have a bigger healthcare crisis, but we have a slightly more manageable business crisis. This is with the assumption that the lockdowns that are happening across the country, they will be selective in terms of places. They will be short in terms of timelines and they will be less stringent than what we had, like, you know, the complete lockdowns last year. So with those assumptions, I think, and businesses are also more prepared this time compared to what they were last year. So I think business impact would be less. in terms of investors, last year they saw that when they were fearful and they sold their stock at probably the bottom of March or April, they actually lost a lot of money that was made later. So I think investors are also more conscious, looking at more longer term rather than worrying about the very near term. Yes, there are certain businesses which have got impacted, and the investors have also reacted that way. So they are worried about financial services, for example. So banking and financial services index took a correction in the recent past. Mm-hmm. The other worries that people have is, so maybe one more aspect of COVID is the vaccination this time is ready and it's being rolled out compared to what we had last year. So people are still hopeful that once the vaccination reaches a certain large percentage of the crowd, we will have less issues, less severity of the pandemic, and less hospitalization and less fatality. So that is also positive, which investors are also looking for. On the other aspect that has been very much in debate recently is the interest rates and inflation. And I think that's one of the things that people look very closely. I would say that if there is an increase in interest rates because of economy doing well, investors don't need to worry so much. From a very low interest rates, if we are moving up to somewhere in the mid-range, it's not a worry because it is being fueled by growth and by growth expectations that are fueling inflation expectations. So I don't think investors need to worry about that. Yeah, at a later stage, when there is a sharp increase in interest rates, at that time, your equity models start discounting cash flows at a higher discounting rate and the valuation goes down. So typically what happens is equity markets reach their peak valuation when growth is good and liquidity is available, which means at the mid-level of interest rates rather than either ends. At low interest rates, the growth is missing. So there is a mistake in saying that because interest rates are low, equity markets will reach their peak valuations. Without growth, equity markets don't reach the peak valuation. So I think it's in the mid-range, which probably we are entering now.
Okay, but how comfortable are you with the current valuations across market caps?
See, last year, Nishant, when we were looking at projecting Nifty earnings growth, it was about 20%. It was 0% in last May. Now we have ended up with a 20% growth in EPS for Nifty for FY21. Pre-COVID, the equity markets were at around 12,000 level. Now we are at 15,000. So we are 25% up. So we are more or less in tandem with how the earnings have grown. In the last 2 years, the government has done a lot to do their own spending on infrastructure and social programs and encouraging private sector to invest in manufacturing. I think we've not reaped the full benefits of these schemes, and which will start showing up in the next 2 years. So I'm confident of growth coming in the next 2 years, apart from that one quarter adjustment we take because of the second wave. So if the next 2 years we are seeing an economic growth recovery, cyclical recovery, I'm not very worried about it, the valuation overall. Yes, in select pockets, the valuations have moved to reasonable or beyond range. But at the same time, there are other sectors which are, I would call as anti-bubble sectors, which have not performed for a long time, where there are green shoots of performance coming better, for example, in the capex cycle of the country. And valuations are still reasonable. So broad market valuations are not very expensive. And I think in Nifty terms, we are trading at about 18 times FY23, which I won't say is cheap, but it's in the reasonable valuation zone.
Okay. So moving to the behavioral aspect of people now. So someone who remains calm under pressure is stoic investor. Okay. So, but in the current situation, because we have been facing health crisis and there's uncertainty in the economy. So how can MFDs and their clients avoid extreme emotional behavior and become stoic investor or MFD?
Right. So first of all, there are two aspects which are very important for every investor to follow. One is choosing the right investment strategy. And second, developing and following a good investment process. Now, when you're developing an investment strategy, one needs to see whether that strategy is based on some very logical assumptions, and two, something that has worked over a long period of time. So maybe 10 years or 20 years, a certain investment strategy would have given better returns. So that is something to be developed. It should also be suited well to your own temperament. Sometimes because of different risk perceptions of different individuals, the strategy needs to be aligned with the person's behavior or person's nature, so that we stick to that strategy even when it becomes a little challenging, especially if there are individuals who are very risk averse and out of fear. If they make a wrong decision at the wrong time, they may actually not get the full benefit of the strategy. So when doing investments, pick up a strategy that doesn't make you stressed. Okay, you should be able to remain calm holding that strategy. Otherwise, you've chosen a wrong strategy for yourself. The second part is to actually put an investment process that helps you implement that strategy. Now, the investment process needs to have aspects or certain behavioral tools which help you in better decision making. Now, for example, people can't get up at a particular time on their own. So if I want to get up in the morning at 6 a.m., I don't know whether I'll just wake up or my eyes will open at 6 a.m. exactly. So I use a tool called an alarm to help me get over that weakness. The same way, a lot of us are, as investors, are vulnerable to noise from the different markets. We get panic along with the crowd or become too greedy with the crowd. So the investment process should see to it that there are certain tools like pre-commitments or certain nudges, behavioral nudges in your investment process that keep you disciplined. Because even if you take a very good investment plan, if you don't follow it with discipline, you will not reap the benefits of that. It's like a diet plan. You can make a nice one on paper, but if you don't follow it with discipline, you will not see any benefits of that plan. So maybe I can also, in your following questions, dwell into certain aspects of behavior that does influence your investments and what can you do about it.
Okay. So Nimesh, what are the most common money mistakes that otherwise intelligent and smart people make?
So again, a good question. So it leads from the previous one. So many a times investors suffer from overconfidence. And this is very commonly seen in retail as well as institutional investors. There's the overconfidence that I can quickly make money in the equity markets. Now, all the broking apps and technology have helped you get easy access to the market. Okay, people can invest in equity easily, but doesn't mean that you make money in investments very easily. And typically bull markets like these make people feel that they can trade in and trade out of the stocks and make money very easily. So this overconfidence is one of the prime biases that affects your investment decision making. Mm-hmm. Many a times people try to get in and get out of certain investment thinking that they can time the exact top and bottom very well. They try to make certain decisions based on less information purely out of overconfidence that they know everything that they are doing. So I think overconfidence is something that is first mistake that people need to watch out for. Second, typically after taking an investment decision, investors generally like to meet people who agree with them. They will speak to their friends or in other investors who also have invested or taken the same investment decision that they have taken. This is confirmation bias. You're trying to collect information that justifies to yourself that this is the right decision I have taken. And actually, you discourage people to talk about negatives about that investment. If you don't know what can go wrong with your investment, then the investment case is not complete. It is not solid. And that's where people make mistakes. They only look for information that is more confirmatory, that tell them that whatever decision they have taken is right. So that's another mistake. The third mistake I see people making is called myopic loss aversion. Whenever they invest in something or they buy a particular stock or invest in a mutual fund, they want the next move in the price to be in their favor. So it needs to move up for them. So they look for very short-term results for themselves. And they try to avoid investments in which there is a chance that price may go down before it goes up. Now, this is also a mistake because a lot of people miss good long-term opportunities by avoiding companies when the crowd is selling them and they are at an attractive valuation and the long-term outlook of that company is good or that investment is good. They try to avoid that and actually miss out on a very big move in that asset class or in that stock. And the last one, I think, which is also documented well, that there is a disposition effect. People take profits very early, but they don't book losses early. So this is where if your investment has gone right, you immediately take profits once you're getting it. Mm-hmm. But you don't take, once you realize you've gone wrong and you're making a loss, you sit with the hope that someday it will break even and I will get out of it, or someday that decision will turn out to be a good decision. So this disposition effect is another effect, which means that you will keep selling your good investments and all your bad decisions you keep accumulating in your portfolio over a longer term. Now that leads to substandard returns for your portfolio. So these are the four I've seen more common: overconfidence, confirmation bias, myopic loss aversion, and the disposition effect.
So Nimish, of late, a few behavioral economists believe that there is nothing called irrational behavior in investment. So they say that the decision people make due to behavioral biases doesn't necessarily translate into a bad one. So what is your comment on this?
So all that a behavioral finance analyst will tell you is that we all have a certain normal behavior. Let's not call it rational or irrational. That normal behavior is that after a point in time, we start using rule of thumb to make decisions, so called heuristics. So for example, if somebody is throwing an object at you, now don't expect people to be so rational that they calculate the speed and the trajectory of that object and whether it will hit them or no, whether it will hurt them or no. By that time, the object has already hit you. So what the mind does is, mind takes a shortcut. Immediately, if somebody is throwing something at you, you duck. Okay. So now these rules of thumbs and heuristics are very helpful. But when you're taking decisions in finance, some of these can actually start hurting you. So for example, fear. Human beings have survived for ages because of fear. Like, you know, if our ancestors did not run away, if they saw or heard a wild animal coming close to them, then we would not have survived, right, as human beings. But now think about it. In the market, if there is, you are suddenly fearful that the market will fall and you sell off all your assets and get out. Now that can hurt you financially quite significantly. So some of these emotions, these biases, we can observe that they are hurting you as an individual when taking financial decisions. And hence it is important to be conscious of these and also put tools in your investment process that help you steer away from them. If you cannot be unbiased, you can at least try to rebias yourself. So I'm not saying that every behavior or bias is irrational. I'm saying this is normal. People are human. Human beings normally behave in a certain way. Some part of that behavior hurts them when taking financial decisions. It is better to be conscious of those and take steps to avoid those mistakes.
Okay. So Nimish, how can MFDs and financial advisors manage the behavioral aspect of their clients?
So in one of the Stoic Investor, I think it was number 25 or so, I have written about something called nudge, which Richard Thaler has written a book on. This talks about influencing people's choice without taking away the freedom of their choice. So in certain schools, for example, where they serve lunch to the kids, they design the whole catering, the way in which the food is arranged in such a way that children choose healthier food. In US also, you would have seen that whenever you go to an outlet, the government has made it compulsory that in the menu, along with the price and other details, you also put the calorie value of that food. So it's not that you're restricting people's choices, but you are influencing people's choices to help them make better decisions. I think that's what financial advisors do. They protect their client from making certain mistakes and create long-term wealth for them. So the few things I have written in within that newsletter for financial advisors is that, one, get your clients to think longer term. I think that's the biggest challenge. Once a client is able to think about a decade or two of investment, suddenly the perspective of investment changes. Then you will not pay attention to short-term noise. You will not be scared about the market movement and so on. So first, look at long-term investment horizon, and all the reports and all the discussions with clients should be about long-term. Your report should have long-term asset class returns. Your charts should have long-term time series rather than, like, you know, what has happened in the 1 month or 3 months or so on. So get your clients to focus on the longer term. Second, expect clients to make errors. Expect the client to come to you and tell you that, like, you know, in the bull market, I want more investment in equities, or in bear markets, have less investment to equities. Actually, they should be doing the exact opposite. So expect these errors and take pre-commitments from them. So when they are in a good mood, when they are discussing in a more calm mood, when they are discussing investments with you, take certain pre-commitments from them that they will buy at a certain dip or reduce their exposure when the market has gone to an irrationally high level. Take these pre-commitments and that will help. The third thing is about using mapping and feedback or visual aids to help make clients understand what they are gunning for. So you can have, for example, certain apps, they give you a kind of a house that you will get if you make a certain investment. And it shows the progression of how that house is growing. So you may have a small house and a bigger house and maybe a villa or so on. So visual aspects tell people that over a longer term, you're moving towards that goal. The second, in one of the apps, I had seen a very nice way of predicting. They put the income and the expense and savings of a person. If you put more expense right now, there is a photo of a young you that is happy, but an older you starts frowning. And as you reduce expenses and increase savings, so the smile fades a bit on the young you, but your older you starts smiling quite a bit. So they use these apps and these nudges, these visual aids, help tell the client that you need to be on the right path of an investment. You should have a right investment plan so that at a later date, your financial goals are realized and you are happy at your retirement or at your older age.
So Nimesh, one last question. Three pieces of advice you would like to give to MFDs to help clients lead a more financially secure life.
So the three ideas, I would say, among the ideas that have helped me improve decision making at Canara Robeco and our investment team, the three things that have helped us very well, I would say, is first is have an investment checklist. So whatever your strategy, what are the characteristics of investment that you're looking for? What are the things you want to evaluate before you get into a particular investment? Have a checklist of those investment questions. This checklist will have all the aspects you want to explore, and it should also have the previous mistakes you have made so that you don't repeat them. So investment checklist will be telling you or asking you questions whether you checked X, Y, and Z before investing so that you don't miss out on any aspect and you don't repeat any mistakes. So that's a very simple and effective tool. The second is doing a scenario analysis, or what we call as a pre-mortem. See, after a person dies, people do a post-mortem to understand what was the reason. Pre-mortem is assuming that suppose a person has died, will die in 2 years, and what is the reason that has happened. In investment, it is like, if I'm buying something right now or investing in something right now, I assume that 2 years down the line, it has gone wrong. So what are the reasons? So look at the bear side or a bear case for what can go wrong, so that you know what to monitor. That also gets over a confirmation bias, which was one of the important biases I spoke to you about. So pre-mortem, scenario analysis, doing a bull case analysis, a bear case analysis will tell people what to watch out through this journey of investing in a particular asset. And the third important thing is having an investment logbook, okay, an investment journal. Whenever a decision is taken, write down a few points about why that decision is being taken on that particular date. Whenever evaluating your investment decisions later, just don't look at numbers, whether it has given you good returns or no. Because many a times, even if you made a mistake, because of good fortune, you have made money. So understand why you invested in a particular asset and what returns it gave you, whether it was luck, whether it was skill, whether it was a mistake that you need to rectify. So all these will help you make better decisions. So you combine the three, a checklist, a scenario analysis, and investment journal. I think that's a very powerful set of making a better decision maker and a better investor.
So with that, we have come to an end to this interesting session. Thank you so much, Nimesh, for your valuable time and inputs.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be talking to you, Nishant. Thank you so much.
Thank you all of you for watching this.